Welcome to our 2016 Newburyport Mayor's Breakfast for Scouting. My name is Esther Sayer and I will be your MC this morning. And I just want to tell you that I had the privilege of receiving this award 2 years ago. And again, I thank you for this prestigious award. Today's breakfast is a very special event for the Boy Scouts of America. We get to honor three well-deserving citizens for their contributions to our community. We are fortunate to have a few special guests, Mayor Donna Holliday, Representative Jim Kalkhorst, a representative from Senator Katie Ives' office, and we also have, from the Spirit of Adventure Council, Chuck Eaton, the CEO, Executive Board members Jeff Reynolds and Brian Sullivan, and Laura Moriarty, the field director. I would now like to ask Cub Scouts and Boy Scouts who are representing PAC 21, Troop 21, and Troop 251 of Newburyport to present the colors. We're going to welcome Pastor Pete Ballantyne from the Hope Community Church, and he'll provide the invocation. Thank you.
Excellent. Good morning.
Morning.
Let's pray together. Lord, as we come together, we thank you for the good gifts that you give us. Lord, we ask for your guidance in our lives, and we pray that you would bless this gathering this morning with unity, with hope, and with vision. Lord, I ask you would build into us a deep respect for one another, that our community may be united, Lord. Thank you so much for these leaders, this great gathering. We also pray for hope, Lord, that you would stir your hope in our hearts, renew our faith. And Lord, we pray for vision, that your vision would fill our hearts and our minds for this community. Lord, would you bless this gathering? Would you bless these leaders and the food that we are about to eat? Amen.
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 At this point, I'd like to ask you to welcome Eagle Scout Liam Woodbury, who will be speaking to us about what it means to be an Eagle Scout. Liam?
Hello. Good morning, everybody. Before I begin, I would like to take a moment to thank everyone in the audience this morning. Your tireless work for this city has transformed it into a place that I am very proud to live in. Despite my college experiences dragging me away from here and into the city of Lowell, Newburyport will always be my home. Thank you all. In my life, I would argue four things have helped guide me to become the person that I am today. Those four things are family, friends, school, and scouting. The fact that I don't see many doubtful expressions in the audience is a testament to what scouting does for the male youth of America. It's a transformative organization that has shaped some of our country's greatest leaders, civil servants, and outdoorsmen. Through it, I've met some of my best friends and some of my greatest teachers, many of which who are sitting at the spinny table over there today. But scouting is more than just community service and camping trips. In fact, I'd argue that personal experiences are the foundation of what makes Boy Scouts such an incredible organization. I believe that I can sum up my experiences in a single story. Rewind with me to February 2015, the snowiest month ever recorded in New England. I was a brash 17-year-old and on the cusp of becoming an Eagle Scout. I had one final obstacle, my Eagle Scout project. There was just one problem. My project, an overlook on the Little River Nature Trail, parallel to Route 95, would have to be built on a freezing day in a place totally exposed to the elements. It took an incredible amount of energy to shovel the path out. The 500-foot path needed to be snowblown the day before, and I owe my family and the leaders of Troop 21 to the fact that it was shoveled out at all. Even after the PAP was shoveled, however, I figured that the hardest part of the project would be trying to find volunteers. For those of you who don't know the process, each Eagle Scout candidate must find a large number of volunteers to help him with his project. I didn't expect to even get 5 people working with me that day. What kind of people would come out to a frozen wasteland on a 10-degree day to do a project? Well, as it turns out, I didn't get 5 volunteers that day. I got over 20. An incredible number of scouts, parents, and close friends showed up to help me on the project. And they did it in a snowy ditch on a frozen day. Why did they do it? Why would any sane human drive out to a remote frozen nature trail to help a 17-year-old build an overlook? Why? The answer is more simple than you'd imagine. It's because scouting represents a call to always be prepared, as our motto says. Always be prepared to help others at a moment's notice. Always be prepared to lead. Always be prepared to follow. And always be prepared to put your best foot forward every moment of every day. My name is Liam Woodbury. I am a proud Eagle Scout from Troop 21, and I will always strive to be prepared thanks to scouting. Thank you so much, everyone. Enjoy the breakfast. I know I am.
And this is what the Eagle Scouting is all about, a fine gentleman like that. Thank you so much, Liam. Newburyport truly appreciates you. I'd like to invite Tim Felter up, please, event chair, to say a few words.
I'd like to thank a number of people. First of all, I'd like to thank Mayor Holliday for stepping forward 4 years ago to sponsor this breakfast, and thank you for your continued support. And thank you, Lois, for all you do to make it possible, too. I'd also like to congratulate the 3 honorees. It's very nice to know that the mayor has chosen 3 people who truly deserve to be recognized by your family and friends and others in the community. There are people here who are present who have been honorees in the past, so I'd like to recognize all the honorees. And if I read your name and you're here, please rise. Sheriff Frank Cousins, Richie Eaton, Georgia Coloris, David Hall, Esther Sayers, Elizabeth Abbey Stearns, Mike Costello, Geraldine Dorr, and Lisa Valsich. I'd also like to thank Newburyport 5-Cent Savings Bank and the Institution for Savings for being sponsors of our event here today. And lastly, I'd like to thank the committee that helped put all this together. If you could just please stand up in place. And thank you all of you for attending today.
Today we're here to honor 3 more distinguished citizens. Steve Hines, Tom O'Brien, and Glee Woodworth. Lisa, Jerry, and Mike were selected as our honorees because each has provided their vision and leadership talents to numerous organizations through lifetime commitments to community service. It's my pleasure now to introduce Mayor Donna Holliday, who will introduce and present the awards to the honorees. Mayor Holliday.
Good morning and thank you. I am so pleased that Tim approached me 4 years ago, and asked me if I would be interested in hosting this event to recognize distinguished citizens in our community. How do you say no to that? It's a joy to be able to recognize people who contribute so much to our community. Distinguished Citizen Awards. Tom O'Brien. I'll just tell you how I first met Tom. I was elected to the city council, and he called me as city council president and asked if I would chair budget and finance. I started trembling. I was like, why could I? But you don't say no to the council president, so accepted the task of being chair of budget and finance on the city council. And having sat through, as a council-elect, this long, difficult, horrible process of how they reviewed the budget, I decided that I was going to change everything. But I made one big mistake. I never talked to the city council president about the fact that I was making all these changes. Tom was not too pleased with the new counselor in her initiative, but after the fact, after we changed the process, he did recognize that this made a lot of difference and was a more efficient method. But I learned early on that you always need to respect your city council president, and you always need to give information and requests through your city council president before you launch off and do something that is going to impact what the city council does. And since that time, Tom certainly has shown tremendous leadership as the city council president. Tom is a lifelong resident of Newburyport. He grew up in the South End, and I don't know if I know anyone else in this community who loves Newburyport as much as he does. If you have time to sit with Tom, he will share so many stories about growing up in the South End, about going to the Immaculate Conception School, about sports. He also was a Boy Scout in Troop 17, but it was his love for sports that drew him away from scouting, because he was absolutely committed to being a wonderful athlete. After he graduated, I think with Richie Eaton, they were the last high school class to graduate from the Immaculate Conception. He went on to then the brand new North Shore Community College and graduated with his associate's degree. From there, he went on to the University of Mass to study history and English, earning a Bachelor of Arts in History. But of course, what would be his favorite part of being at UMass? Watching Dr. J play basketball. He went on to Springfield College to earn his Master of Education in Vocational Rehab Counseling. From there, 37 years, and many of you probably don't know this, 37 years he was a counselor with Mass Rehab Commission, working with those with disabilities and helping them return into the workforce or get their first jobs. And in addition, he was a career counselor at Northern Essex Community College. His public service began as a member of the Water Board. He did that for 5 years, and then, whatever possessed him, he decided to run for Ward 6 counselor. And he won by 6 votes. After the recount, it was 8 votes.
Landslide.
Yeah. But he has served the city council in Newburyport for 8 terms as city council president. And he is known for running an efficient meeting and a very professional meeting. And we thank him for that. He also, for most of you probably don't know this either, that he served as on the executive board of the Newburyport Housing Authority for 21 years. But for Tom, it's always sports, and that's something he has never lost as he's moved on to other things in our community. He's an athlete, he's a sports announcer, a coach, a fundraiser, a volunteer, and of course, the ultimate fan. But Tom says today, the most important athlete for him to watch is his 9-year-old grandson, Tom. Tom quietly serves the city he loves, where he grew up and has given back as a public servant, through sports, volunteering, and the hundreds of people that he has served as a voc rehab counselor, and especially as a city council. And for all those reasons, Tom, you received the Distinguished Citizen Award this year.
Thank you for this award. I'm going to give it to my pride and joy. Thank you, Mayor Holliday, and thank you for your nomination. I'd like to thank people for being here, everyone for being here, especially my wife and my daughter, Katie, who have, over the last 20 years and 5 years of on the water board, I had to miss a lot of things at home. They've been very helpful to me and very thoughtful and thankful and appreciative of me giving back to the community. I also like to thank people for being here. I'd like to thank my two nephews, Sean and Scott Sullivan, and my campaign manager, who helps me get a lot of signatures every year, Dan Sullivan. I appreciate it. And my favorite niece, Carrie Sullivan, who many know works at the bank. And my favorite person, my pride and joy, like I said many, many times, Tommy, welcome. I'd like to thank the Boy Scouts for putting on this award. As the mayor said, I was in Troop 17. I had many fond memories. My younger days playing the St. Louis de Gonzaga Rectory, where the head scoutmaster was Richie Eaton's father-in-law, Red Holbrook, who taught us many things about being prepared. And when we went out to, I talked earlier to a gentleman, I said, well, you know, I like the scouting, but when we went out to the staying over and sleeping out in sleeping bags at nighttime, that wasn't my scene. I liked it the next year when we went back when we slept in cabins, it was very much so. So I'd like to thank all the city councilors who came here to this meeting too, and they also put on an ad in the program, which I appreciate. I appreciate the thoughtfulness, giving up the time to come here today early in the morning and give up their business opportunity to be here to honor me. It's something I'll never forget. I've served on city council for 20 years, and I went through last night and got all the records, find out how many city councils I've served with at the time. I think I've served with 39 city councils, different city councilors, 6 different mayors, and if you count the time I was on the water board, 8 different mayors. So, you know, I've seen Newburyport change a lot. You know, I love the city. As the mayor said, you know, I think I bleed Newburyport. Even though I went to Mac Conception, I bleed Clippers. I clip a gold. So, you know, I've worked with a lot of mayors. Mayor Holliday, Mayor Clancy's here today. You know, we learned a lot together. We helped move the city along. Hopefully it's been for the better. Hopefully the residents appreciate all the work the mayors and that I have done, you know, but anything I've done for the city and any compliments that I ever get from my work in the city is because I love the city. This is Newburyport, you know, like I said, I was born 70 years ago, and I think the 3 award nominees, I think we're all native, so there aren't many of us left, so I appreciate it. You know, it's good to have, you know, get the award with Glee Woodworth, who we've known for many years doing the work around City Hall and the cemeteries, and I know Steve, because Steve, we, a couple years ago, we played softball together in the Adult League, and I was talking earlier that one of my first cars I bought was a Green Monza, and who was the salesman in Ainsley but Mr. Stephen Hines, so, you know. So, like, again, I thank you all for coming, giving your time to come here and honor me. I appreciate it. It's like I said, I'm a new reporter. I love New Report, and this is something I'll never forget. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tom. Our next recipient is Glee Woodworth. Glee stepped into my life probably 5 or 6 years ago. I was newly elected as mayor, and had a really concerned about the fact that we weren't doing a very good job of telling our story, telling the story about our history, our wonderful, rich history in Newburyport. And I also realized that we're supposed to have all the mayor's portraits. You put it up after you leave office, so we should have 67 mayor's portraits up at City Hall, and we were missing 5. And I wanted to know where they were, and I was standing looking at the portraits and sort of talking to myself, and it was Molly who came up behind me, Attenborough, and said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm counting the mayor's portraits and we're missing 5, and how do I find them?" The next day, there's this woman with a clipboard standing in the middle of City Hall, and she's writing things down, and I said, "Excuse me, who are you and what are you doing?" And she said, "Let me introduce myself. I'm Glee Woodworth." She found the 5 portraits, she cleaned them up, she polished up all the mayor's portraits in City Hall, and she also, that was the start of all the things that I got to know that she did for the city. When you're in City Hall, take a look when you come in at the Weights and Measures cabinet on the left-hand side when you first walk in City Hall. It's magnificent. Guess who restored that? Glee Woodworth. So Glee, she was born in Newburyport and is a 12th generation descendant of Robert Adams, a first settler of Newbury. She graduated from Newburyport High School in 1976 and headed south to attend graduate school and then to work in Arkansas at Hendricks College with the Assistant Dean of Students. She joined the Peace Corps in 1991 and worked as a volunteer in East Africa. She then became a Peace Corps trainer for new volunteers and a mentor for national staff at 13 countries, including Armenia, Namibia, Turkmenistan, Bangladesh, Niger, and China. She has visited more than 35 countries during her time in the Peace Corps, including Oman, Syria, Nepal, Madagascar, Turkey, Morocco, South Africa, and Jordan. After more than a decade of traveling abroad, Glee came home. Her next journey then began, her study of history, and she has earned the distinction as a historian while offering over 100 tours and presentations about our local community. In 1988, Glee's father, Todd Woodworth, had created a tour of Oak Hill Cemetery that all of us know about, Tiptoe Through the Tombstones. And boy, did he tell great stories about the people buried in that cemetery and their contributions to the city of Newburyport. In 2006, Glee took over this role of giving tours and taking people through the cemeteries and telling, again, these amazing stories. But in addition to taking over for her father, she also has some pretty significant accomplishments. She created the Clipper Heritage Trail, for those of us who can pick it up on our phone or with maps, and you can walk around the city and study and learn about the wonderful history in Newburyport. Her book, Tiptoe Through the Tombstones, a multi-award winning, telling stories about, again, about the cemetery and people's contributions to our city. She has coordinated an amazing gravestone restoration within Oak Hill and Old Burial Hill, restoring over 1,400 gravestones. And of course, all of her amazing tours, I would encourage all of you to take the time to join up and take a tour with Glee on one of her, there's so many that she does besides the cemetery. She's now on the river. You'll really enjoy hearing the history tours that she has put together about our community. Another piece is that she's raised over $90,000 for restoration of the Brown Chapel at Oak Hill Cemetery. Amazing asset that has been brought back into our community. So researching, learning, designing and creating, those are words that come to mind when I think of Glee. She has added so much value to our community, and she has positively impacted thousands and thousands of people with her service, both abroad and here in the community. And for those reasons, Glee receives the Distinguished Citizen Award. Thank you, everyone.
It was about, it was after 2004, my last trip overseas with Peace Corps. I was training volunteers in Armenia, and I was worn out. And I had been looking for full-time work for a few years around that time, and I kept rejection after rejection after rejection. And I was talking to a Peace Corps friend, Ellen, on the phone, and she said, "Glee, maybe this is where you're supposed to be, Newburyport." Well, that was 10 years ago, and I think it's worked out for the best. To the young people, they disappeared. Well, there's a few Boy Scouts, and Tommy here. Wherever you are, whatever age you are, and wherever you are in this world, whether you're on an island in the Pacific Ocean, a big city, a small town, or a mud hut village in Africa, get involved with the community. Your life will be enriched along with the communities. Thank you to all the sponsors. Thank you to the banks and the different organizations who have supported my projects during the past 10 years. And it's a wonderful, sponsors for the Boy Scouts. It's a great young people's group, and thank you to all those volunteers who continue to help young people in the variety of ways they do in the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Glee. Our next recipient, I know most of you in this room who are natives of Newburyport, who he is also, have much deeper relationship with Steve Hines. For me, it really began when I became mayor and got to know him through his work on the boards in our community. And I'm so glad that I've had a chance to really get to know this amazing man. A Clipper, always. That's how we describe Steve Hines. He played sports, football, hockey, basketball, track, and he fondly remembers being coached by Jim Stalen. He was a positive and influential coach and teacher to so many students and athletes in Newburyport. And Steve helped the event we had this past fall where we dedicated the World War Memorial and Jim Stalen Field. And we're all grateful for his support in helping that event take place. So he graduated from Newburyport High School in 1974 and went to college for 2 years and then decided to join the Mass State Police. He became a state trooper. He returned to college to earn his Bachelor of Science in Criminal Justice from Western New England College in Springfield. Steve enjoys boating and fishing, and probably that's what drew him to first sign up to be a commissioner for the Harbor Commission, and we are very fortunate to have had him on our Harbor Commission. He's also now on our Waterfront Trust. I won't say anything else about that. It's a challenging committee, that's all we'll say. And I'm very grateful to have him serving on that committee also. But when he was on the Harbor Commission, Steve was very helpful in working with the other commissioners to help the city win the 14th national designation as a Coast Guard city. This is not an easy award, and as the birthplace of the Coast Guard, we were really, really fortunate to have received that recognition. In fact, Washington said that the application that Newburyport put together, thanks to Steve and other members of the Harbor Commission, had become the new standard. We are now waiting for our renewal. I understand Rear Admiral Vogt has signed off on it in DC and is moving it along. So we anticipate having the opportunity to come together as a community to redesignate our community as a Coast Guard city, hopefully sometime in November. And I know Steve will be standing right there with us during that event. When Steve was 24, he met his amazing wife, Susan, and they had their first child, Derek, on July 9th, 1980. And then three more children followed, Michael, Ashley, and Trevor. As a Mass State Trooper, Steve's job entailed public safety, highway safety, and homeland security. Working as a public servant and a first responder clearly speaks for itself. For almost 34 years, Steve worked in this capacity, always going to towards danger to protect all of us. A lot of sacrifice for his family also. Steve and Susan and their children were faced with a devastating tragedy when they learned their son Derek, a first lieutenant in the Army, was killed on September 1st, 2005 in Afghanistan, as he, like his father, went towards danger to protect others and the soldiers he served with. But what's amazing about Steve and Susan and their children is that they turned their deep loss and sorrow into creating a foundation. The foundation is the First Lieutenant Derek Hines Soldier Assistance Fund, and it provides assistance to families in Massachusetts and soldiers who have incurred serious career-ending and life-altering injuries while in active duty. For your public service, Steve, but especially for the many families that you have helped, today we recognize you with a Distinguished Citizen Award.
Thank you. I'd like to first thank the Boy Scouts for hosting this event, and thank the mayor for selecting me. Also, congratulations to Tom. As Tom said, we go way back. We played back in the 70s, softball, fast pitch softball was big in Newburyport, and we played at Perkins Playground was a field, and it was a great time, a lot of fun back then. And so Tom and I go way back. Lee actually was in high school with me, graduated 2 years behind. Congratulations, you're doing a great job carrying on the history of Newburyport. It's very important. I'd also like to thank my wife, who pretty much is the impetus behind me and keeps me going. She's like an energizer bunny. everyone who knows it probably realizes it. She keeps me young, keeps pushing me, and thank my family also for being with me and keeping us together and keeping us moving forward in a positive way. It wasn't and isn't always easy, but we do it through the help of family and friends. It just, you know, like I tell people, the grass continues to grow and someone's got to mow it. So, you know, you've got to hold your head up high and keep going. State police, I had a great career. My police career actually started in Newburyport. I can remember sitting in Mayor Richard Sullivan's office like it was yesterday. And he says, Steve, he goes, you're number one on the fire and number one on the police list. He goes, you have your choice. What do you want? And I said, well, I'll take the police. So I was on the Newburyport police for about 6 months. And I got my letter from the state that I had been accepted into their academy. So I had to go back into Mayor Sullivan's office and tell him I was leaving. And he said, you're leaving? I said, yeah, I'm going to got accepted to the State Police Academy. He goes, oh, that's great, Steve. He was great about it. He goes, you know, I'll give you a leave of absence in case it doesn't work out. And I said, no, Mayor. I says, I don't want that. I says, I'm not coming back. I can't have that in the back of my head because, you know, I said, I'll get it done. I'll make it through it. Back then it was a little tough and made it through it. And I'm here with a classmate of mine that graduated from the academy with me back in 1983, and we finished our career. We graduated together. We worked at the Peabody Barracks together, which is no longer there. It's a DPW building now. We went to the Topsfield Barracks, which is now Topsfield Police. We worked at the Newbury Barracks together, and then Andover. Tom went on to be a detective in a lot of drug units. I was a detective with the Racing Commission. And then I finished up my career the past 13 years at Logan. Tom's still paying tuition, so he's hanging in for a few more years. But it was a great career, and you know, I wanted to leave on my own terms. I still, right to the last day, I took pride in spit shining my boots and wearing that uniform, and I wanted to leave on good terms like that, and I did. So it was a wonderful career. When I got the call this past year from Charlie Cullen about the Stalen Monument, Charlie didn't realize Coach Stalen and my history, and he asked me who had done Derek's monument on the bridge, and I told him, and he said, do you think you could call him for me? So I said, sure. I said, he's pretty busy, Charlie, but I'll call him. So I called up, his name's Bob Shore. I called him up, I said, Bob, you know, are you busy? He goes, Steve, I'm always busy, but for you, whatever you need. And so Kevin Stalen and I went down and we went through the whole process to get the monument built for Jim. And if you haven't seen it, you gotta get up there and see it because it really, really came out nice. And it was just an honor to be a part of that. To give you a little history, the day Derek died, Jim Stalen was at my house that afternoon. So that's the type of person he is. He had an effect on me and still does today. So. With Derek's foundation, after he died, the city was wonderful. It's amazing, and they still are today, the community support. People were sending money from all over the country, and we had this money, and a group of West Point alumni and friends had held a golf tournament. So we had all this money, and we just said, you know, what are we gonna do with this? And I said, well, We met family members and close friends, and we met and they said, you know, Derek was always about his soldiers and helping others, and I said, we can donate the money to existing nonprofits, or we could form our own nonprofit and continue Derek's mission. So we took a vote amongst us that day, and we voted to continue Derek's mission. And it's been 10 years now. It's been a great way for us as a community and a family to honor Derek. Initially, we had a few golf tournaments, a bingo night, and then eventually Sue kept saying, I want a road race. And so we decided upon a road race, and we met. And when we were talking, picking a date, one of the people on the board, Bill Coulter, a lieutenant in the state police, he goes, why don't we have it on Flag Day? And we just, it just hit us. It's perfect, you know, it just worked. And it just, it isn't even a race. It's a community event, you know, and every year we have it. And Sue and I look at each other, it's like, oh, do we have to do this again? You know, and it's like, and everyone says, yes, you do. You know, you've created such a great event. And I like this, we have sponsors here. The banks have been wonderful over the years sponsoring us. And it is, it's not a race. It's just a way for people to get together and honor the flag, honor their country, honor those that they've lost. And this year here, we were fortunate to have Medal of Honor recipient Ryan Pitts, who served with Derek in Afghanistan, to speak. And I think anyone who was there realized that, you know, just a great young man, great speaker. And a day or two later, I said to Sue, I said, boy, what do we do next year for a speaker? I said, who's going to top that? It's like after Liam got done speaking, I said, well, I have to speak after him? He did a great job. So Ryan called me that next day. He goes, just want to let you know, Steve. He goes, Amy and I are coming back next year. He goes, we had a wonderful time. He says, and we're going to get Sal Junta there for next year. I says, good, then he can speak next year. So Sal Junta is also a 173rd member that served with Derek, a Medal of Honor recipient. So we're trying to get him here. So next year we may have two Medal of Honor recipients. The 173rd, Derek's unit, was, and still today, is the most active unit. They have three Medal of Honor recipients from that unit for their time in Iraq and Afghanistan. It's been a great thing for us. The race has been a way to bring those kids back. The past couple of years, we've had several members of that served with Derek come. It gives us a chance to meet with them. And last year, you know, they came back to the house afterwards. And just to give you an idea how important this is to these young men, it's like one of them came up to me, he goes, Mr. Hines, he goes, I just want to thank you. He said, you know, I hadn't seen these guys since we left Afghanistan 10 years ago. He goes, I never thought I'd see him again in my life. He goes, but because of the race, he goes, I'm here. He goes, we're back together. He goes, this is so important for us. He goes, and for me, he goes, I'll be back every year. And this is a young man that came home. He was in Massachusetts for 3 years. I didn't realize it, but he got his master's from Harvard. And while he was going to Harvard, he actually used the home base program. He was struggling a little bit. And he went to home base, and he told us that. He told us that you know, home base helped him during his time here. Now, this is a young man that now is doing great. Just last Friday, Sue and I got to go to the Red Sox game, the Friday night game, in the Red Sox suite. And we invited all the soldiers from the area that served with Derek in the 173rd. Along with a couple of sponsors, and just to see these guys back together again, it's so important for them. And they're all doing well. They're all a firefighter, state trooper. You know, they're just all doing great, and it's so important for them because, you know, when they're over there, they were kids. They were 18, 19, 20 years old. Derek was old at 25. You know, he was a college graduate. He was their father. He was babysitting them in Italy, you know. He said, you know, it was a struggle in Italy. He goes, it's easy once we're here in Afghanistan because they just do their job. But these were kids, young kids, and now they're really turning into great young men that are doing great things with their lives. Sadly, there are those that still suffer. You know, our fund, I hate to say it, but we've paid for a funeral for a family that couldn't afford a proper burial service. For their son that had committed suicide. So we would much rather give to a program like Run to Home Base than pay for funerals. We've done a lot. We've done many different things with our you know, proceeds. All board, you know, all funds go directly. You know, all board members have volunteered. No one is paid. So it's a program that we're really pleased to see. Bringing these young men together and seeing them get on with their lives. I think the mayor met a few of them, got a chance to speak to Ryan last year, and they'll be back again this year. And so it's fulfilling to us as a family to see that good things came from something bad. My work on the I take pride in when I was on the Harbor Commission, I was involved with the Coast Guard cities. I was involved in the early stages of the Harbor Masters facility, which is now being built. It's great to see that being done. And now on the Waterfront Trust, I enjoy being on that. It's not as much of a challenge as everyone thinks it is. We've got a good group on the trust now. We all get along, and we get along with the other boards. I mean, the bottom line is we're all stakeholders in this. You know, none of us own any of it. You know, we're all stakeholders, whether it be the NRA, the Waterfront Trust, the Harbor Commission. It's ours. It's the city's. It's the citizens. It's everyone's. It's open to everyone. And I just always keep that in mind, that, you know, we're all stakeholders, and let's do the best for everyone. Make the best decisions that benefit all. And, you know, being a part of that has really, I enjoy it. I know Sue doesn't really care if I have a meeting tonight or I've got to go down the waterfront. You know, it's like, what? Another meeting? What are you going down there for? And it's like, well, you know, these are the things you have to do. But the waterfront has been such a great part of my family. And I just want to hope that my grandchildren will be able to experience what my family has experienced with the waterfront and the river and the ocean and everything. And so in closing, I always like to bring a little bit of Derek when I speak. You know, Derek, when he was in Afghanistan, he kept a war journal, and he talked about, you know, building different buildings, and, you know, they would hunt terrorists at night, but during the day, they built police stations and schools, and they actually finished a school, and to quote him, he says, it's giving me great satisfaction that we're going to get this school built. He goes, no contractors have ever wanted to come into this area to do any work. He says, this will be our mark when we leave Afghanistan. They did finish the school. A soldier that served with him actually sent me a picture of the school. So Derek was a difference maker, and, you know, if we all can just try and be difference makers in our own little way, you know, we'll be a better world. Thank you.
I understand that from Representative Kalkhorst and Senator Ives' office, we have some citations to be presented to the recipients. Would you please welcome Representative Kalkhorst? And from Senator Ives' office, Dennis Masala. Thank you.
Steve, I just want to start out by saying, if I can be a fraction the difference maker your son was, I'll know I'll have lived a great life. Thank you for him, and thank you for everything your family does. It means the world to me. I want to thank the mayor, and I want to thank the city council and the Boy Scouts for this. My son is a proud wolf here in Newburyport, so it's a great pleasure to be here this morning. The senator and I and Dennis Marcello from the senator's office have a few citations here for today's recipients. The Comet Glee Woodworth, where is Glee? No, there she is. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the State Senate, and House of Representatives, we have official citation, be it known that the Massachusetts Senate and the House of Representatives hereby extends its congratulations to you in recognition of being selected by the Mayor of Newburyport to be recognized by the Spirit of Adventure Council, Boy Scouts of America, for your outstanding service to the community and its citizens. And be it further known that the Massachusetts Senate and House extend best wishes for continued success, that this citation be duly signed by the President of the Senate and the Speaker of the House of Representatives, and attested to and copy thereof transmitted by the Clerk of the Senate and of the House, by Stanley Rosenberg, President of the House, of the Senate, and by Bob DeLeo, Speaker of the House, Kathleen O'Connor Ives, Dennis Marcello, and myself, James Kalkhorst, State Rep, 1st Essex. Thank you, Glee. Council President Tom O'Brien, I love seeing you, and I love seeing your grandson all the time. We have a great time, and you know what? He's a heck of a dunker as well. Just keep him away from that dunk tank next year, please. The State Senate and the House of Representatives, be it hereby known that they extend their congratulations to you in recognition of being selected by the Mayor of Newburyport to be recognized by the Spirit of Adventure Council, Boy Scouts of America, and for your outstanding service to the community and its citizens, and be further known that the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives extends its best wishes for continued success, that this citation be duly signed by the President of the Senate and the Speaker of the House and attested to and copy thereof transmitted by the Clerk of the Senate and of the House, by Stanley Rosenberg, President of the Senate, and by Bob DeLeo, Speaker of the House, myself, James Calcourse, and Senator Kathleen O'Connor Ives and Dennis Marcello. Thank you, Mr. Council President. And last but not least, Stephen Hines. The State Senate and the House of Representatives, be it hereby known, hereby extends their congratulations to you in recognition of being selected by the Mayor of Newburyport to be recognized by the spirit of the Adventure Council, Boy Scouts of America, for your outstanding service to the community and its citizens. And be it further known that the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives extend their best wishes for continued success, that this citation be duly signed by the President of the Senate and the Speaker of the House, and attested to and a copy thereof transmitted by the Clerk of the Senate and of the House, by Stanley Rosenberg, President of the Senate, Robert DeLeo, Speaker of the House, myself, James Calcourse, 1st Essex State Rep, and by Kathleen O'Connor Ives, Senator for the 1st Essex District. Thank you very much.
Today you've heard a lot about community service, and the Scouts have been committed to service for over 100 years. In fact, one of the five fundamental elements of our youth development, which also includes leadership development, advancement recognition, character building, and outdoor appreciation. Please turn your attention to the video as we show you the good we do.
Free to discover the world around them. It answers their need to play, to search, and to learn for themselves. We still let kids be kids. The Spirit of Adventure Council provides opportunities for children and young adults to develop their leadership skills. In scouting, kids learn by doing. By taking on leadership responsibilities, young people learn the skills of leadership. All scouting programs allow children and young adults the chance to lead their own activities. And throughout their time as a youth in scouting, young people get age-appropriate opportunities for leadership development. The council supports many programs and events to train kids to be leaders. In today's busy world, we rush from one thing to the next. Although it may be the most important question in our minds, there hardly seems to be enough time to stop and think about the good we do. The value of a purposeful life is ultimately measured by how we spend it. It is said that life is short. If that is true, then the time of childhood is exceptionally brief. Youth is the formative period with so much going on. Bodies grow and so do minds. Habits, relationships, values, and interests are all determined when we are young. Because this time is so short, there is an urgency, an instance of opportunity to make a difference. This generation, perhaps more than any other, needs the Spirit of Adventure Council and the Boy Scouts of America. Together, with your help, we can do something really good. Your support today can bring the good of scouting to thousands of children and young adults. You can improve the quality of their experience today, and at the same time provide fuel for the effort to reach more kids who need good scouting. Helping young people grow is perhaps the best way to show the good we do.
I'd like to ask Chuck Eaton, CEO of the Spirit of Adventure, to come up, please.
Well, thanks very much. Thanks to all of our honorees. Thanks to our committee. Thanks to all of our contributors. Really appreciate this. It was really such a wonderful and heartfelt theme of community that really ran through today's comments and all of our honorees' remarks. Really, it must, obviously I'm not a Newburyport native. Our council starts just south of Boston and runs all the way up here. So we're sort of in the northern point of our council, and it runs west to about Dunstable and Lowell and those areas, 76 different communities and towns. The things that you folks talk about in Newburyport are the same things that we talk about in every community that we serve, whether it's Mattapan or Newburyport or Lowell or Reading. Really the same sorts of things happen. And they happen because scouting is a part of them. Scouting really builds community. Those of you who are parents of scouts, whether your scouts are now 35 or 40 years old, or your scouts are Wolf Scouts or Cub Scouts or Girl Scouts, just raise your hand for a second. I just want to get a real sense of sort of our parents of scouts. Great, great. Scouting really is parents working together to help raise each other's kids. And when a scout troop works effectively, it works effectively because those parents are bonded together. And they're bonded together around the common ground of what is best for their child and what is best for their child's friends. And it's wonderful to watch families learn and work together as they do that stuff. So they sit down together one day when all their kids are in first or second grade, they shake hands and they meet each other, and they realize, oh, we need a treasurer. Well, luckily, one of the guys named Larry happens to be a banker. Larry, can you be our treasurer? And that's the way, right? Did I do that right? And that's the way that that works. And somebody else is an avid camper. Great, can you be our scoutmaster? Can you be in charge of getting us out there? And somebody raises their hand and said, let me take care of the snacks. And someone else says, let me take care of the transportation. And somebody else is, and all of a sudden these parents are working together. That not only works and bonds the parents together, that models that type of community for those boys. They know that their parents are friends, and they know that their parents are pulling together. So when they're out on the camping trip and they have to work together to make sure that they eat their meal and light their fire and clean up their pots and pans so they can get to their next activity, those are all things that are modeled by their parents. And that stuff has a generational and a multi-generational impact on the way in which a community is formed. And then Liam comes up and he talks about, shockingly, that on a horrible snowy day, 20 people from his community, from his life, put down what they were doing and came out to help him improve the community. And he's surprised by that. It's generation after generation of growing that type of community. And that's really what scouting does. It grows character, it grows leadership, certainly no doubt about it. It teaches young men how to set goals and achieve that goal. When I'm 11 years old, I wanna know what it's like to be an Eagle Scout. I have a book, it tells me exactly what I wanna do. I'm gonna set a goal that I'm gonna achieve when I'm 16 years old. That's real, that happens every day. They set a goal to earn a merit badge, it takes them 3 months to earn it, they go through it. It's not about, I want to get, you know, it is a long-term goal, and that is a huge learning lesson, life lesson that is embedded in their soul by the time they achieve their rank of Eagle or just Star or any other rank that they, or any other merit badge that they go to earn. You folks are contributors to scouting. Thanks a bunch. It means a ton to us. It's how this thing really works. All of those video shots, all of those photographs are all from our camps. This council serves 76 communities. We have 5,000 volunteers. We have 13,000 kids. We have 2,000 acres of land. We have 272 buildings, from little tiny latrines to giant dining halls to indoor swimming pools. It is a massive undertaking. All of those resources and all of that human resources of all of that volunteer time, to some degree, has been mismanaged for a long time. It's why scouting isn't as vibrant today as it once was. I'm sure those of us who have been involved in scouting can think back 20 years ago and say, oh yeah, there used to be two or three more troops or more Cub Scout packs or more Girl Scout troops in our town. And then those of us who have been involved for scouting for 40 years, we can look back and say, oh yeah, there used to be 10 more troops and 10 more packs and 10 more Girl Scout troops. We're losing that thing. There's a cultural change going on. So when you talk about business and when you talk about things like this school closed and this police barracks closed and these things change and move and alternate and switch. We merged our councils about a year ago, which is a conglomeration of over 20 years. We merged 7 councils together. But if we don't change the way in which we serve and build communities, then all of those mergers will be for nothing. So we have a very, very ambitious change to our business plan that helps us meet the needs of parents and meet the needs of kids today. We are incredibly excited about that. If you've been in a business industry, if you've been in an industry that has gone through mergers and tried to reallocate resources like 2,000 acres worth of land, which by the way, if you know anything about scouting and camps, people have a deep, heartfelt attachment to their camps. Did I do that okay? So as we repurpose things like that, and as we figure out how to rearrange all of those assets, and when you talk about managing 5,000, we don't manage, we lead or we help inspire 5,000 volunteers. Those are 5,000 volunteers, they don't get a paycheck. They're doing this for a very different reason. And we're asking them to think a little bit differently and go in a different direction. This is what we need to do if we're gonna make scouting thrive. And we need to make scouting thrive because scouting builds community, scouting builds character, scouting builds integrity. Your contribution today is the best business investment you can make in your community. We will use it wisely. It is a super exciting time to be a part of scouting. It is super challenging. You guys have made a tremendous, great decision and a great impact on scouting today by your contribution and by your time. And our honorees, thanks so much for your kind words about scouting. Really appreciate it. Thanks for helping us build community. Thanks.
I would be remiss if I didn't recognize when we have 2 city councilors left, but thank you to all the city councilors for showing up here today. It's really appreciated. Steve, Tom, and Glee, thank you for all you've done for our community. It's people like you that truly are distinguished citizens. Thank you for everything you've done. This now ends our mayor's breakfast, and thank you all for coming, and I wish you all a great day. Thank you.